Nantucket Windows asterisk 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 Nantucket Windows by Edwina Stanton Babcock, author of Greek Wayfarers, The Flying Parliament, etc. The Inquirer and Mirror Press, Nantucket Island, Mass. 1924. Copyright 1924. Edwina Stanton Babcock to Annie Barker Folger, by whose fireside and off islander first learned to love the charm and grace of Nantucket. Hospitality appreciation is expressed to the National Magazine, the Nantucket Historical Society Bulletin, the Nantucket Inquirer and Mirror, and other publications, for permission to reprint some of these verses. Contents page: Nantucket Windows 9, Doc Drama 10, Ghost House 11, Song of Scarlet 14, Pathmaker to Maria Mitchell 15, Prophecy Made Going Down Along 16, Coast Yon 17, Bouncing Bet 19, To the 90s 21, Structures 23, Psychoscience 25, Beacon Lights 26, Wheel 27, Nantucket in France 29, Fishing on Steamboat Wharf 31, The Wallace Daisy Field 33, Youth and the Old Mill 34, Scissors Grinder 39, Whispers 41, Not the Gift but the Giver 43, The Ball 44, The Town Clock Gives Advice to the Tourist 46, Cup 50 to a Bram Query, The Last Indian on Nantucket 51, 3 a.m.m.53 on the Jetty 54, Windrow 55, The Swimmer 56, In the Antique Shop 57, The Cardinal Flower 58, Wild Bird 59, Sabatia Pond 61, The Lost Dryad 62, Patran 64, Roof Tree 65, Evening at Franklin Valley Farm 66, Vision 69, Lost Beauty 70, An Old Man Tells a Story to Some Boys 71, From a Window 76, Responsible 77, Tree Worship 79, Another Chance 81, Dark Minstrels 83, The People of Today to the Clergy of Today 84, Protagonist 85, Signal Fires 86, Martyr 87, Ballad of the Thorn Tree 88, Balloons on the Beach 89, They Pass 90, On the Beach 91, Saul's Hills 92, 2 Sea Measure 111, In an Old Burying Ground 112, Christmas Eve on Nantucket 114, Song of the Lightships, A Landlubber's Chanty 116, September Noon 118, Main Street by Moonlight 119, Psalm of Imagined Hunger 121, The Moon Canoe 123, Deprecation 124, Nantucket Windows Out on the Night They Glimmer, Island Houses, Casements of Orange Luster on the Moors, Dune Hidden Panes Where Winter Sea Carices Shine on the Roads That Wind Past Farmhouse Doors, The Island Windows Gleam, and All the Sorrow of Human Life is Lanterned into Dream, The Fishers' Huts Are Splashed, The Grey Shacks Borrow Red from the Sun and Weltered Moonlight Gleam, Out on the Dock, Gold Patches on the Stable, Light Stippled Wharves, Ruby and Malachite, Sharp, Slanting Roofs with Witch Like Peak and Gable, Plaqued in warm squares of ruddy window light. Thin blocks of amber in the misty weather, oblongs of white translucence on the down, dim, tawny lights beyond pine-hidden heather, clear coastward lights fringing the steepled town. The grey owl flaps across the heaving hollow, the chimneyed house sinks in the common's wave. The cottage lights 100 starlights follow, the island windows shine, the road is brave. Doc Drama limp in his chair a tilt against a shack. An old man broods o'er a newspaper and smoke where shingle quilted pent roofs back to back checker from grey of ash to black of coke. Dim squares of window, opal paned, baroque, waver on water, purling it to deep weed-wafted droop of shifting shadow cloak where swirls of silver imagery sweep. Slow ribboning to the surface serpent rings of mast reflections quiver into grey upon the incoming tide that softly brings one high-peaked sail along the buoyant way where questing water tentatively steals fingering mossy spiles and undulant keels. The steamboat docks a stage where nightly speak the actors in some ribald skit of trade. Here serried barrels screen a jester's freak and piles of trunks made pirate ambuscade. Red lanterns slackly swung and lights of jade accent accordions pert canzonette, or furry trawls along the string piece laid trip oil-skinned fisherman's hulking silhouette. A massive barge-like enigmatic tomb toward a sea-scented land of dark drifts down, dim on the east the sandy headlands loom till dawn rings up green trees and steepled town. Then like applause in broken scattering sound the motorboats speed to the clamming ground. Ghost House. I had always felt contented about that ghost. There in her vine-shrouded house aside of the road, I knew that the rag-stuffed panes were her special boast, that she liked the tumble-down chimney of her abode, she liked that old hat that hung in the tree in the lane, and the scarecrow leaves that dribbled around in the rain, the ivy that muffled the sills, a ghost would adore, and she reveled in cobwebs the twisted staircase wore. The dear, mild thing I thought, she's the only one in this glittering, piecework world that can run a home, no wonder the birds to her leaf-hung windows come, no wonder the black mole tunnels the garden loam, and there is revelry under her knotted boards where wild kittens hide and the grey squirrels rattle their hoards. But some eager, fidgeting, worldlings came one day, moved into the house on a heavenly morning in May, of course the ghost could do nothing but move away. Lord, the cutting and hammering, planing and scrubbing and suds, Lord, the paint and the polish, the grates and the curtains and duds. The new beds, the cleanness and trimness and all. I looked for the ghost in the mirror that shone in the hall, I looked for her round the curve of the varnished stair, I searched and called for her, wistfully, everywhere. And what will you do, dear ghost, was my whispered cry, and where will you live your shadowed reverie? Where do ghosts go when no longer they have a home? Do they pile their effects in a van and begin to roam? Shall you take to a haystack or sleep in the church's dome? Whether she heard me and thought it could not be true, or guessed that she might not trust me, the ghost made no ado, though the pale grey thing may really have cared that I knew, at all events, she moved, and her shadowy store of belongings exists for the world no more. That house by the road, more correct, I think, than most, has lost its chief charm. It no longer has a ghost. Song of Scarlet. The black alder berries are thick this year, it's going to be cold. Their scarlet trinkets, their necklaces bold hang on the shivering wind-swept year, it's going to be cold. Now, the commons are bare and the leaves whirl around, it's going to be cold, like little brown sparrows flicked over the around, it's going to be cold, but the black alderberries like rubies embedded string out on the heath where the milkweed has seeded. It's going to be cold. Now the wind feels the blind and the roads look severe. It's going to be cold, and the locust tree's horned pods rattle and shake, and the small bony branches grow brittle and break. But vitality lingers in reindeer moss, and near the home holly the thorn berries toss. The bright alderberries gleam saucy and bold. Pile up your wood fires, who cares if it's cold? Pathmaker, to Maria Mitchell, in those eyes, dark as pools, the morning star must have lain long. On that calm breadth of brow must have been set some nobleness of vow to distance and to space and all things far. A little narrow street enshrines her now, but through the world her planet pathways are blazed with her name. The constellate gates UN bar to those who, following, her star cairns know. Woman, who walked with science to mark the lights along dark ways. Thy luminous steps are dim, wrapped on ethereal roads of satellites, art gazing still through space beyond the brim of sparkling nebula meadows to the nights of some new radiance or a still farther rim. Prophecy made going down along. Don't tell, but I think there's a miracle today. The old North Church is full of western light, and the bush nearby is afire. Very bright shine the windows in the tower. For the last half hour some starlings have ranged their whistling and calling. The barometer is falling, it's underground moon this week, you know. Don't tell anybody I said so, but I think there's a miracle today. Somewhere on the island something's going to happen. Don't ask me, I don't know anything about it. Whatever I say I'd just as lief shout it, but there's going to be a miracle today. If there's any pass at all a going your way, better say, there's going to be a miracle today. Don't tell them who said so, they wouldn't like it, hey. But there's going to be a miracle today. I know it for sure, for I've stood for 1 hour watching those starlings in the North Church Tower. So if you want a gam, it's sure I am that there's going to be a miracle today. So that's the drift, though maybe they'll be miffed, he hasn't got the run of it they'll say, but there's going to be a miracle today. Coast yarn. Skies pebbled with stars, sea, breathing like a sleeping animal, wind nuzzling wet shagginess of moors. The coarse bright strains of an accordion, perversely stretched and shrunken against a wall of dark. Brown faces, high cheekbones, polyglot sea words, a cold, dark swiftness. Hardness of diligence for shrewd, tight-fisted gain. The cranberry pickers dance gravely in squalid shacks on the moors, and the greasy bottles pass from old lips to young, rough doorways blurt out light, white teeth, dark eyes shine. There is chattering wharf talk and garbled dockyard French, clam diggers, scallopers. Fondle their dirty rolls of smoky dollar bills and stride in booted ease. Out of the moorland night she, saucily, slips in, thistle down on her hair, little, slim, earringed, scarlet bloused, her feet and impertinent breasts form mischievous mongrel words in a universal language, her mouth gleams like berries, swamp light in her eyes. Someone clasps, someone curses, then screams, a knife. The sea, like an animal panting, the sands, scared and white, broken barrels of cranberries strewn like unholy rosaries, a man, stripped and bleeding, thrown overboard at midnight where the tide runs strong. On a small brown neck a long gold chain to match new earrings. Bouncing bet. Sauntering narrow lanes led by the weather vanes see beneath narrow panes Nantucket gardens where little fruit trees lean on old walls gray and green dappling ivies screen Nantucket gardens. All that is best and fair like old scent lingers there shrubs, herbs and ramblers share the sweet disorders. Tall tapered hollyhocks foxglove and purple phlox demure mints, frilly stocks spike the box borders. Yet, past the rose-hung doors called by the tangled moors bouncing bet left them. On new strange roadways bound was the career she found when she bereft them. Ragged pink willful thing. You had to have your fling with weeds to roister. You could not breathe the air of mignonette, nor care for sweet peas cloister. Only, these have a name, theirs is the garden fame they are traditioned. Out on the dusty ways bouncing bet weary strays quite ill-conditioned. Yet I have heard the cry go up from passers-by, young, therefore tragic escaped. The little word to them is not absurd, they know its magic. Therefore, dear bouncing bet, you may have honor, yet yours may be winning, but in your saucy pride, though you would not abide gates, gardens, walls, beside, were your beginning. To the 90s. On Sundays when the church bells ring their island-towered summoning I see the 90s go gravely around the narrow-cornered way as they have gone for many a changing day steady and slow. At twilight before window lights are lit I see them, white-haired, backward musing, sit beside their narrow pane and then to me who wander through the streets the new life with their old and living meets and they are young again. And always, by the great hearth's roaring fire or in the spring-lit street, or by the door I hear their sober speech, with them live o'er old days, see the stiff backs that bow under the life so hard upon them now, yet frugal, busy. Gathering up the past for memories that serve them to the last binding their faggots slow of what they know. If e'er the turbulent world can settle down to live if e'er we learn to suffer and forgive to work hard with few pleasures and great faiths we shall invoke these tottering, smiling wraiths and we shall smile and whisper softly true it was the old, who knew. Note. One year when summer residents returned to Nantucket they were informed that there had been a great falling off among the 90s that winter, and it was noted that much vivacity and charm had gone from the island social gatherings. Structures. They have taken the old houses, lovingly they have taken them, bound up their wounds, bandaged their aching sides. Made them soft friendships of pretty paint and kindnesses of mortar. They've made little paths this way and little paths that way and cosseted and crooned and coaxed and cared, till the old houses, the very old houses, stand up quite proudly with a dear and ancient pride. All day long they meditate. In spite of all the pretty paints, in spite of all their mended ceilings, do they meditate on the old houses, the very old houses that they were when they died. And so I suppose with the old ideas, rickety old ideas, heartbroken shapes that stand in field and sky, cleverly we repaint them, cleverly decorate and give them quite new hinges. And open them up and brick them in and hold them, all that is good in them, away from ruin. Yet, all year long the old ideas are walking, all year long the old ideas are talking, talking through our every act and glance, in spite of all our efforts to be new and useful, in spite of all our efforts, we go acting by the rickety old ideas, the shapeless, bulged ideas, the mildewed, damp ideas that have died. Psychoscience. He, who is far from home, knows when the snow gives way before the sunny urge of spring, when the first ecstasies of bluebirds go through blossomed loops and boughs be murmuring, when briar roses starrily compose upon the scented spray, he, homesick, knows. He, that is far from love, knows when the face that knew his face is raised to summer stars, he, like that other, hungers in his place, and, like that other, grips his prison bars, and when that upturned face can no more smile, he knows, and whispers comfort, mile on mile. He, who feels far from God, knows when the word comes light upon a golden shadowed hill, on his dim path the radiance has stirred. Deep in a dream he shrines his knowledge, still keeping his thorny ways, intent he goes, knowing the hidden that infinitely knows. Beacon lights. When I am cowardly, sick of the fight, dumb for the right word, nerveless for deeds that dare, blaze up in my heart, square little brand point light, light me a broad path starred with a burnished flare. If I am tossing on a sea of doubt, and have no harbor, no fair shore to know, sang Katie, like an angel, spread your great wings out, headland and coastward light, give me your glow. If I am lost and waves go over me, tossing, engulfing hollows o'er my head, thou, great point light, will surely cover me, and by thy strong white clue I shall be laid. When I am caught in foam of treacherous beach, and all the darkness presses like a wall, blaze, island lights, beyond the island reach, beacon me to the utmost light of all. Wheel. The growing's finished. Down the garden ways the gardener comes, slow trundling his barrow. He brings a load of curious loamy mulch, brings tools that cut and stab the earth, that lop the boughs from off full-blooded trees. Under the falling leaves the gardener stands, unshocked to see the tulip and the rose, red haw, brown seed pod, lily staff and leaf, all lying dead, extinguished, passionless. The gardener smiles to see the adventurous bee lying cold killed under a broken stalk, smiles on a battered moth with frosted wing. He spreads black clods of compost on the beds, sifts ashes all around the roots of trees, lops off, cuts back, prunes, digs away and kills. Knowing how, out of the ruin and wreck, pure glowing things will come, new winged forms, trees that shall say new things to listening souls. O unseen gardener of the world tree, boughs ripe with strange star fruit dropping in the fields of vast space gardens, give, thou, me to learn in simple ways, how, after this life's dream I may accept new growth, even to loss of this life consciousness, to help thy plan. Become, for thee, a dried up flower cup, a butterfly unwinged, broken plumed, even a blinded, helpless, light-killed moth, so that I nourish forth new growing things in the star-branched garden of deep time. Grant that this brain, that dares to dream of thee, as father, friend, taught of the sentient flowers, shall dream, dream on to some far endless end. Nantucket in France. They would take the hill next day, the order, he knew, and the kind of hell the taking would be, he had seen, so he spent the night awake and the hours flew, as he pondered on the sort of man he had been, and wondered what dying and doing it bravely would mean. The 82nd's coming along tonight. He remembered then. There were men in that regiment knew his island home. Men that were going to fight for the moors he loved and the pines where arbutus grew. Well, he thought he would like to pass them a word or two. He thought he would like to see them, to talk of the hill by Pulpis Harbour, the grey little farm roofs slant, of the way the sunset flared through the fans of the mill, and the rolling moorland hiding the plover and brant, and the scallopers sailing their boats through autumnal chill. He thought he would like to talk of the gilded dome of the Unitarian Church, of the cobbled square, and speak with others seafaring names of home, wondering, do they hear of the fighting there where St. Katie Light stands guard with its solemn flare? So he stood all night, on those dark hours of the earth, calling to men slogging by to heroic ends, shouting, Nantucket, little grey town of his birth. Palely he stood there, anxious as one who sends SOS scanning the night for friends. Nantucket, he hailed, but the river of men rolled by, every eye set grim towards its mecca of bloody drench, no answering island voice took up his cry but his own soul answered. He went back to his trench resolving how a Nantucket man would die. A true incident. Fishing on Steamboat Wharf. High all our prisons, we can no more out, words meant to free us, compass us about, and a sigh means a laugh and a hymn a battle shout. But here silence mellows starved being into life, with these dreamy fellows, rod, reel and jackknife, even the caught fish are blithe. Green water laps the spiles, the silence is golden, every little whiles I am beholden to a sea captain of a time olden. He puts on the bait of quarog, that gets me a bright little flipper, or a place fish nets me, that I'll haul in a whale he occasionally bets me. Silence and fishing, sun, understanding, fun to see off islanders tack in and miss their landing. Quiet winks exchanged while tobacco you're handing. No boasting here. No meanness with minnows, commonwealth of bait debts only finnows, and a great quiet kindness and much colour blindness. Maybe it comes from looking down so deep, where much is hidden and much lies asleep, with your eyes on the line, given you to keep. Quiet pipes lit, quiet eyes reflective. Rips a silver fish from out the perspective, to go fishing on the wharf is my one great objective. The Wallace Daisy Field. Slim pointed pickets guard the summer dream, glimpsing behind their lichen-scrolled bars, young shapes of white that in ethereal stream toss starry incense to the summer stars. Ranked slender acolytes in Harbour Lane, communion bear to many a churchless breast, processional in falling summer rain, recessional to gold and gothic west. Only a daisy field, yet one man's care enshrines it in immaculate gated reach, inviolate flowers veil them mistily there, spreading like moonlight to the moonlit beach. Where the white patterns disc the tabled green is read the sacred word of sea and skies. Chapeled within this occult daisy screen is sacrament for beauty-loving eyes. Youth and the old mill. Youth, old mill, grind me corn for my house by the thorn, for I'm with the old folk, where the pigs in the poke and the cows in the barn and the peats on the stone and the latch string out thrown. Old mill, grind me corn for the winter morn. Old mill, no grain can I grind thee, modern child, my sails are tattered, my grindstones scattered, my cranks are riddled with rust defiled. But I'll turn you a dream, a great town dream, at which many have smiled and been beguiled. Youth, turn me a dream then, doughty mill, flaring there on your windy hill with your rickety arms spread on the sky, black crows from the cornfields passing you by, near the burying ground where the Quakers sleep, and the sailors home from the ranging deep. Turn me a dream, you strange old mill, keeping your watch on the windy hill. Old mill, shall I turn you a dream of the town crier calling his news gainst the tempest bawling? Shall I turn you a dream of three Vikings sailing the rim of a low-lying island hailing? Turn you a dream of a smuggler grim and the underground path for his mates and him? Of three forms walking a midnight road to a lonely farmhouse where one light showed and a paper signed with a white quill pen that helped bring freedom to slave-born men. Of a man who made a telescope and lassoed the stars with a mental rope, of the woman who worked in a cottage small, whose name in science leads them all. Of a knight who came and built a school. Of a woman who broke a cast-iron rule. Of the Quaker forms and the gentle ways that ruled all war out of the ways. Of the Indians, watching the sun go down. Of the whalers and gold-seekers of renown. Youth, nay, old mill, I laugh in your face, turn me no dream of a Quaker past. Turn me no dream of the tranquil ways, turn me a dream for my own tense days, turn me a dream for my cherishing, a dream for believing, a dream for my strength. Old mill, shall I turn you a dream for your loneliness? A dream of the star-scattered faces about you, and the plans and pleasures and pains that flout you. Shall I tell of the voices that you must hear before some one voice calls you clear? But whatever it be, for joy and sadness or triumph, defeat, or grief or gladness, that I cannot know, said the old mill very low. Youth, nay, old mill, if you know the voices that make for a bold life's chance and choices, turn me that dream. Old mill, only the sound of one voice you shall hear, a voice that has known your soul forever, a voice that has called you and kept you wherever you failed or won in your high endeavor, the voice of your dream. Youth, O mill, give me no mystery, I know the way of human history, turn me true dreams. Old mill, only the dream of beauty I know, the long sky paved with the afterglow, the moonless bog and the shimmering seas, the floating mist through moorland trees, the quiet color of twilight dunes, the night heron croaking its ebb-tide runes, the black-walled sky and the star-strung vines, the pooling spread of the island pines, and the sea's voice borne on the salt mist breath, where the chained arbutus wander wreath. The strange glad swerve of the moorland road and the great black shoulder of the wood. Only these things I know, said the old mill very low. Youth then, old mill, since no dream you grind me, a dream of my own I will surely find me. But as youth weaves and catches the threads of a hundred human joys and dreads, youth sees the old mill standing there, high on the hill with the west aflare. And dark as it looms on the sky, it seems the old mill steadily turns out dreams. All's well grinds the grave old mill, all's well grinds the brave old mill, if your eyes and your heart hold loveliness, and your mind and your soul know faithfulness, and your eyes and your hands know steadiness. You shall walk straight over the rim of the years to the vivid land of all conquered fears, with your heart set true and your eyes set straight, you will grind good dreams from the grist of fate. But that's all I know, said the old mill very low. Scissors grinder. 'Twas long ago they said of the country whence I came, Greece is a dream that is dead, Athens only a name. Yet on this April day as I go through the towns, I see soft Thessaly on these New England downs. I see the lilied plains where the white cranes droop their bills, and the moving cattle trains winding into the hills, while the farmer drums his bees, and the donkey shakes his bells under the olive trees where the Bay of Corinth swells, to great blue silver gate where the sea-bound temples wait, and the Eleusinian way mistily winds the bay. On Knossos's shady knolls I see the columned tiers, and the cool Ionic scrolls throb to Olympian cheers. I see a graveled stream winding Olympian reeds, again the Scythian dream its wagoned people leads. The river god drifts on, raising a poppied head, a pipe sounds halcyon, nothing of Greece is dead. But I, who walk the towns to sharpen knives at the gate, feel sharper knives in the frown of this new world's estimate. Whispers. What was it the wind said? Blowing from the orient to the cross on the hill, and the fans of the mill. What was it the wind said, blowing at twilight, to New England? The wind that blew from the east blew dreamily, a low song and strange song had the sea. The islanders sought each other's eyes, and young men dreamed enterprise, then sails put from the shores. And wives stood alone at the doors, for the old world, the strange world, called to New England. White sails stole out on the silver sound, they ran into storms outward bound, they could not stay home and they would not turn back, for the old world, the dim world, called to New England. Now, in the old house where the chimneys stretch wide, young wives talk by the fireside, on the walls there is delft, and the lacquered trays, jades, teak and teapots, fans of gallant days, china, tortoise and pearl, ivory carved like lace, cheddar, cashmere, sandal, in some secret place. And what say the young wives? The frank young wives, to the stranger's face. No one guessed how they knew, nor what the wind said, and the sailors are gone and the merchants are dead, but the toppling summer sea, and the pale blue winter world, came often and oft again, and the years like sails furled. Men died on the ships and were buried at sea, men languished on wild coasts. Lost in mystery, no one knows what was said nor what answered again, when the wind blew a strange way, the wind blew a new way, for Nantucket men, and the old world called to New England. Not the gift but the giver. Suppose that o'er the blue thin circling line where low clouds sleep, some figurehead should shine, white swelling sails spread out on fan-streaked skies, and a new vessel in the west should rise. Suppose this vessel, from untraveled zones, through savage suns and fierce Euro-Sildens should bring me deeply buried in its hold a mystic gift of jewels and blazing gold. And, having safely brought the precious thing, should spread its sail, augment each shining wing, and calmly, like a night bird through the stars, speed on again, crossing the distant bars. Then through the mists go out before my eyes, leaving me standing there beside the prize. I, left on lonely shores, would ever mourn the messenger that sailed beyond the bourne. I, left on lonely shores, would only pray to see again the ship that sailed away. I, searching the horizon's purple round, would follow ships, hither and thither bound, longing for this, to see the dim prow lift, that brought to me my longing with my gift. And so with thee, who broughtest me thy truth ablaze with jewels, alight with mystic signs, then vanished. Lo! With what utter ruth, the sorrow of my gift my soul divines. Holding with yearning talismans of thee, who hath passed on beyond the touch of me. The ball. How do we see our world, formless? Vague. A rude sphere hurled through space. A green kaleidoscope of trees, and the flash of seas. And life and movement in every place. I see my world with color wet, with the golden sap pushing the green to the ardent sky. I see the ripeness, the warmth of fruits, round to the sun, plumed melody, the clasp and the subtleties of roots. I see God's walk on the morning hills, up the dappled brooks and the secret lanes and vistas leading to ferny haunts, where the vivid crimson cardinal flaunts in calm of tree-pillared fanes. I see my world star-fretted, caught in the web of enchained eternities, with the age-old moon on her stair, cloud-wrought, climbing the night sky's precipice. I see the silver wheel of tides, the night spell hid in the forest breast, the gold-splashed dawn that gravely glides over grey mountain crest. O world, whirling out with the sun, and holding us, everyone, when the golden sky's twilight lean to the purple hills, what have they seen, who were born, still blind, in a web of days, to thy lessons written in simple ways? Dull streets choked with dusty forms. Crowds and houses and groups and swarms who strive, and lose, and are gone again. A world of sordid women and men. A crowd of petty and dull and mean. Not a flower face nor a splash of green, unless, O world, they have seen it all, the miracle of thy wonder ball. The town clock gives advice to the tourist. If you walk on Main Street, turn your fancy loose, out of lace and lacquer you may pick and choose, poetry of race and clan, demure maid and solemn man, all the lore is stored away in these houses brick and grey. Puritan and worldly wise trod these stones that meet your eyes. Hoary old aristocrats, old chairs, parrots, lace and cats, old umbrellas, ivory canes, whale and ship for weather vanes, soldiers' monument and bank, shops and studios in rank, new sails spread or old sails furled. Main streets where you meet the world. If you turn in Salem Street, better have a care, the law is on your left and the red jail is there. They don't burn witches, but you'd better beware. If you walk on Whale Street, roll some in your gait, make believe that caravels for your coming wait, square-rigged and clipper-built, wind-jammer and schooner, will bear you off on cruises if not later, sooner. On North Water Street salt creeps into speech, looking down the little lanes you will see the beach. All along North Water Street, please to make a note, all that's worth saying is said about a boat. If you walk on Milk Street, keep your wits about you, don't let any saucy star on Vestal Street scout you. Curtsy to the old mill, snatch a rose from arbor, Milk Street's a nice street to come in harbor. If you walk through Pleasant Street, you are sure to see many brilliant knockers shine reflectingly, gardens full of spicy bloom, and real ladies taking tea. If you go through Orange Street, you will have a glance at Japanese poetry and English romance, you'll smell paint, hear some radio, and see among the wise a scholar with a Christian's face, and two great grey eyes. If you walk through Center Street, you will surely meet a true woman with voice and manner sweet, and there the windows fairly talk, and the fences are so neat. If you walk through Lily Street, the sun sets at the end, honeysuckle claims you like an old friend, and quaintly blocked upon the skies old houses on Gull Island rise. If you walk through Quince Street, never stand and stare, hollyhocks will ask you to go otherwhere, apples growing you may see, raspberry and pear tree, wisdom and a pretty wit if you know where to look for it. If you walk through Joy Street, take a little heed to keep a fairly sober air, dignity you'll need, there's something about Joy Street goes to the head indeed. And when you are in Gay Street, choose a sober pace, clematis along the fence, shakes its stars like lace, and twinkling little cups of flowers toss in a sheltered place. If you look for money, there's New Dollar Lane, and Mill Street, another street with a pirate pointing vane, consulting maps and other code you'll find the $1,000 road. And last of all, wherever you walk, stagger through Stone Alley, slip along the cobbled stone, slide methodically, honeysuckle may evade, birds shilly shally, but a good place to meet a maid is in Stone Alley. Howe'er you walk in any street, wear a pleasant smile as if you hoped to meet a dream before the next mile, and you may find that dream waiting by a stile. Cup. I walked among them with my cup of blue, it was aflame sometimes, and sometimes trembled with sweet of all the exquisite things I knew. Yet was I feared to tell the draught, dissembled, my wish to have these strangers taste the brew that to my lip all sky and sun resembled. I walked among them, holding up my grail, holding it steady, bidding to the drinking. It was the best I knew, luminous, pale, changeful and fiery in its bubbled winking, I watched its vital depth grow warm and sunny, ethereal bitter, sometimes sweet as honey. I walked among them with my cup of blue, they laughed and turned to chatter at my rapture. What cup is this, they asked, of simple brew? What UN sure wine, what grail of dullards capture? This is no drink to slake our fevered dryness, this mead for us would hold but acid wryness. I walk among them with my azure bowl, to feet and marketplace and to the threshing, Today there is no feast, there is no soul but craves the cup I bring, nor its refreshing, and yet in vain I raise my flashing beaker and pledge my toast to truth and the truth seeker. To Abram Quarry, the last Indian on Nantucket, when the long shadows fell across the wind, and the dense sheep moved greyly on the moor, how was it with you, Island Amarind, sitting dream-bound beside your shimmer door? Did tides that curved the ripples to that shore remind you that somewhere the source must be that sent you, outward ripple of a race half-spent, bewildered son of hidden continent? Dark, dying Indian, with grave hand bowed in untaught dreaming of dark ancestry, sawest coast and vineyard and the stalwart crowd of young red men embarking on the sea. Or up great rivers in some land of rain, in swift canoes chasing the brilliant feather, or dancing god thoughts in the harvest weather. All gone. No trail. No scrolled birch bark sign to hand the tale from father down to son. What meaning was in totem's reptiled line? What old taboo in crest and trophy won? What mightiest chieftain led the hunting bout, or what dark sachem fathered all the swarms of circled firelight's solemn squatting forms? Maybe the outward trail was marked with stars that shone of old in ancient weather book, perhaps old campfires lit old forest scars, or in the sky where some great spirit shook a mighty spear, perhaps thy brothers stayed to welcome thee, when stern and unafraid thy moccasined feet fared those mysterious trails that aqueous time like clear brook water veils. 3 a.m. He came and sat with me, that one whom we so fear. And as I looked closer upon him, lo, I felt myself unfearing. Death, I asked, why is it that no man athreed, nor understood thee? Then he gazed with that dark glory of his eyes, answering, if men could know how I yearn toward them, if they saw the things that I would show them, yet, could trust, accept, come to me kind, like little children. It were well. 'Twere well, indeed, if this could be. I am afraid of life, said Death, and smiled at me. On the jetty. Still the old rage, O sea. Blue lightnings buried under snowy shock of white foam bodies dying on the rock, such sobbing passion to be still more free, still the old yearning. Sea. Still the old secret. Sky. Cloud galleons sailing for some coast of dream, and robber winds a gallop for the gleam of western gold where purple banners fly, still the old questing. Sky. Still the old bondage. Heart. Slave to a beauty that defeats the mind, enchained, whose bondage even yet may find true words, the whole glad wonder to impart meaning of sea and sky and thee. O heart! Windrow. Old figures in a lane, toward the grey church going, vines tapping on a pane, strong wind blowing. Old comers by a lane, heads bowed and hoary, stiff knees and tapping cane, wind knows the story. Old patterns in a lane, toward the grey church going, follow through veils of rain, brown leaves blowing. Old blooming through the lane, pods, grey and brittle, wind, bring all back again, young, gay, little. The swimmer. Tonight the ocean calls, the stars respond, white scattered through the skies, swift through the cool of curling wave he hies, who swims far out, nor sees the shore receding, only his strength, his long bold measures heeding. Proud in his power, strong, from hateful touch of hands that haunt him, free he plunges forward through dark wastes of sea, passionate in the careless joy of roaming through billowed gulfs, forgetful of his homing. Tranced in the summer night, lying far out on the high-breasted deep, he dreams alone. Lo! In illumined sleep, white naiads gleam in dim sea groves and hollows, under the tide-drawn heaving path he follows. Until the stars slip down, and to far shores the pale night drifts away, then he turns back to meet the break of day, through the broad surges in blind rapture leaping, until he feels the sand and the foam creeping. In the antique shop, all day the silver-headed craftsman bends over the broken chain, the gemless rings, the voiceless clock, the fragile fan, and mends with delicate fingers rare broken things. I gaze on him, on gems and glimmering gold, see light restoring touches, magic skill, till to my heart come strange imaginings of ruined lives I know, shattered and still. O craftsman! Here is metal, dull and old, look on these broken lives. Canst thou remold? Canst thou, with color, love designs refill, bring beauty out of sorrow's patternings? The cardinal flower, wrapped in his crimson gown and cowl, beside her slender form he stood, there by the grassy brook they strayed, and sunrise thrush and moonlight owl knew that she listened while he wooed. So blue her eyes, so golden fell the sunny hair about her face, she stepped with delicate sweet pride along the grasses, close beside the brook's cool lily-shadowed place. It was a shame that they should go thus side by side, at last to part earth said, mine all this color now, her soft blue eyes, gold hair and brow, the red blood in his ardent heart. Men say, they died. They passed away, I am not sure what trail they took. But where the grasses bend and sway, red cardinal flower burns its way, forget-me-nots grow in the brook. Wild bird! I said I had tamed them all and caged them, the myriad birds of my dream, called them by docile names and paged them, with law and precept I engaged them, and I sat with my tame birds all around me, sat where you others came and found me. See, here is Ardor, his wings are clipped, and here is Truth, with spotted breast, imagination, preening her plumes, adventure, stolid, in golden barred rooms, my myriad birds, my wild birds of no name, all tame, like yours, I said, all tame now, tame. And I sat with you, friends, and was suffered of you, the bird fancier has tamed her birds, no fears. And I sat with you, listening through my tears. For there was one wild bird, one I left wild, to see that there ever had been with me such as he, one wild bird, clean as the sky, and free. There come cries sometimes, black ducks, grey gulls, plover, wild swan, sickle-billed curlews, there are long dotted streamers across the sky of freedom and quest that cannot die. There come songs. And I sit and smile, with my tame birds preening, from my window leaning. Then he flies by the casement. A stir of wings, a shape on the stars, my head lifted, my heart on fire. My soul on your wings, wild bird. Sabbatia Pond. Where the soft circle of Sabbatia stars, the water grasses in a sprinkle dark, and golden ripples break on sandy bars, and thin blue sails of dragonflies embark, I think each year, how many sunsets weep, that day must die, and tinted tears must fall there where pond ripples to white clethra creep, and where the margins sweet with honey ball. I think that where those sky tears placid lay, that golden evening stars have also lain, reflected on the rosy surface. They have dreamed a dream, and wandered on again. So, where the sunset clouds in sorrow crept, now rosy shapes through water grasses trail, and on that bed where gypsy starlight slept, is left a rose-colored star-patterned veil. The Lost Dryad. I am a lost dryad, wandering tranced in the lovely blossoming wood, following paths where the shy bright berries wait, entering glades where the birds have secrets and nests. I am a lost dryad. One came who woke me and bade me come forth. Gladly I stepped from the tree and put out my hand. Gladly, like children, we hurried forth to the sun. But our play was only begun ere a bitter will had hushed it. I am a lost dryad. I cannot go back to the tree. The bark is mended and closed. I cannot remain in the wood, for the flowers are dumb and reproachful. The birds are afraid to have my eyes on their nests. The brooks have closed their waters like windows that gleam. I am a lost dryad. And so I wander in smiling pride of my state, purer than woodland things that will have none of my pureness, wiser than human things that do not reck of my wisdom, lost in the dream of a thing that was dimly shown me, bewildered, though calm, broken and proud like a princess. I am a lost dryad. Ye who listen in the trees, oh, never come forth unless ye have spells to bind the intruder unto thee. Unless ye have spells to hold the enchantment forever, stay in your tree prisons. There at least there are weavings and pleasant scents as of home and things familiar. I go wandering forever, alien and speechless. Chance that broke the bark of the tree is formless and vanished. Now the healed heart of my home no longer opens. I am a lost dryad. Patran. Does the moon love best when the trees write fortunes on the west? When the webs are done, all the milkweed spun, and when brown roads up to the blue sky run. Does the moon love best when the budding creeps from the sunny south where the crocus leaps, and the robin cheeps, and the earth is a-blossom with rain-wet mouth? Does the moon love best the wild winds driving out of the north? The hazel rod, and the brown seed pod, and the autumn censers swinging forth. Oh! The gypsy moon, wandering ways so silverly. Hers is the love of cricket shoon, and wigwam corn, and the smell of morn, and October grasses on vagrom dune. Roof tree. Far from the highway stands the empty home, with unhinged door and warped and shrunken stair. Over its walls the chilly shadows roam, rank to its lintels huddled ivies come, past its blind face the startled swallows fare. Wrapped in its memories, it stands aloof, strange to itself, patient in wind and rain. No tender hearth breath curls around its roof, No voice within welcomes or calls reproof, no child's face peers behind the cobwebbed pane. Let us not wonder why, we shame it more with echoing voice and stir. Let us depart, turning in pity from the hapless door, closing the dumb gate in awed silence, for this is the dead hope of a human heart. Evening at Franklin Valley Farm. 1918. The lantern throws a wavering shadow round the umber aisles. The cows in Stanchion's Road turn their soft gaze. Their curving horns surround the fragrant tossing of their rustling food. Their limpid eyes, their breathing, slow, profound, seem on some great unworded theme to brood, some evenness of sky and solitude, or placid pool or hill with maples crowned. From stall to stall the horses' darkling eyes and upflung heads connote our interlude, and scenting nostrils wicker their surprise at human forms that on this peace intrude. The shadows smell of milk, and straw, and rude farm implements accent the lantern patch, ringed globules tremble on the bundled thatch, leaping to dusky beam and rafter wood. Past horned head and ponderous chestnut flank, the fitful light dance swings along the floor, and wanders to the star-specked aqueous blank made by the sliding open of the door, a snowy feather, where the pigeons soar, wavers adown, and odors keen and rank filter through darkness of a minster grey where filmy cobwebs swim along the hay. Perhaps these beasts of burden wait once more for wise men, and are shining all around, to see redemption by the manger door, illumined faces on the rushy ground. Perhaps they draw their slow breath, tranced and bound, instinctly taught that they new forms shall wear, who shall some day be swift, no burdens bear, and have their tongues made eloquent in sound. But, if the hallowed shining does not come, and they look through the dark with unchanged stare, and if those great grave mouths stay always dumb, 'twill not be ignorance but some truth they share, who have no doubts, no clamorings and no fears, but faithful to the clumsy guise they wear, walk patient down their plodding driven years. While we in princedoms of our God's own form, wistfully pause in their oblivion light, longing to stay with uncouth beasts tonight, for that their calm would keep our spirits warm and soothe us back to the glad human norm. Would gladly share with them their sacred things, their freedom from our restless questionings, so we won quietude from stress and storm. Mingling our vigil with their burdened speech, their reverie. We would take of that wisdom they can teach, learn how this comes to be. That brooding in the silent darkness here, slaves of a labor lasting all the year, they, and not we, become the masters of tranquility. Vision. I saw the searchlight, like a seraph, fly over the water's moved mysterious face, bridging the harbor, pushing darkness by, pouring its flood upon a far-off place. I thought, no gleam can travel where they wait, no human light throws silver on their shore, their crystal seas unmargined like the great love which they know, and rest in evermore. I thought, no light can show the flowers they bear, their heaven looks, the tender things they say, no light reveals the aiment that they wear, nor all the bliss of their unwearied day. And yet, who knows? So long have yearning men turned to those borders searching, wistful, gaze, what stainless light may flash upon our ken, what glorious faces smile at our amaze. Dim reaches wait, untrodden shores exist. The sea of death completes the solemn scheme, but comes the light to sweep away the mist, and comes the heart to rightly read the dream. Asterisk, 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 I see the searchlight in the years to come, moving anew on borders strange and far. I see new coastlines set with lights of home, men's faces turned toward a near-burning star. Lost beauty. Because my fathers did, I seek my bed while winter night over my dreaming head opens its gorgeous book of trees and stars upon a world that sleeps. The eastern bars are crossed by ships, all constellation-shaped, that sail the winter hills where snowy trees are draped. So I, whose muscles and whose blood are bound to this faint-hearted scheme of life, do pray those that come after me, that they shall found some life that does not sever night and day, so when God's fleet sweeps up the midnight skies, his starry ships will hail unsleeping eyes. The branch of strange berries. An old man tells a story to some boys. Black tunnels grooved the sea into caves of night, and the furrowed walls of foam were jagged chrysolite. No star stayed to chart the way, we shuddered, lurching on boiling spray in piteous plight of swinging stay and black sails torn to flapping rags, blowing in knots and bellying bags. I could not sleep, I walked with the salt caking in rifts on my face, and I heard my men up in the bows cursing our dreary case. They ground their bitter words in their jaws as we reeled in the furred sea's tigress paws. Paladin came with his eyes of omen, his loose mouth hanging dry. Senor, he said, we men leave women. He turned and sneered at the sky. Maybe your love is the love of the ghost that shrieks your name from a rock-cursed coast. But we know there's no land like the land thou dreamest, no land like thy boyish fancy deemest. Man, if thou knowest the way, turn back over the lost and surging track. The men are mad for the food they lack. Two ships are lost. The water skins sag. Scurvy's aboard, the torn sails drag. Saint Mary, thou knowest there is no land offers food nor place for our starving band. Thou and thy dupes our lives have hurled white bones on the reef of a western world. With your jewel-bought quadrants and kingot gold our homes and kith and kin ye have sold. Paladin whined. Turn back over the lost and tossing track, up from this dreaming, silly and slack. I turned on him, I shook my head, through burned and bleeding lips I said, sail on. Sail on, I said. Though it seemed to me I spoke from the dead, sail on, I said. Then came all terrible wolves of that crew, staring at me, half dead, they knew, yet maddened because my words were few. The blood was gone from their hanging skins, the rags hung dank on their horny shins, they mouthed and muttered, his eyes roll wild, he babbles now like a peevish child. O shame, thou madman! Thou dangerous mind, that dreams of a country we do not find, while we with the blazing sea go blind. Art minded to sail till the last one's dead. Sail on, I said. All night we climbed those seas that mounted, towering to skies that nightly counted the empty coin of the foreign stars. We saw foam rips on the rock-reefed bars. The sea shuttles kept up their ghastly heaving on looms of white their black cloth weaving, and I thought that they wove me a winding sheet that slowly wrapped me from head to feet. Day after day the salt spray caked on my sunken eyes that burned and ached, and the curses fell as my body fell. I lay slant like a corpse on the all-day swell, were it day or night, I could not tell, but they called for my blood, yet, their knives were keen for the blood of a man, whose fault, I ween was, he sailed for a country he had not seen. Day by day muttered hate, thick slime oozing from mouths that judged my crime, till they told me, you die. And set the time. I crawled to the bow and looked out ahead, for the time was short and the land I dreamed hidden, but near, meseemed. And then, Jesu, atop one foaming wave the miracle road, the carved stick, knobby and rough, its black bark brave notched with rough taboo words and signs of living beings, strange words and lines. And then, O Mother of God! It sailed, the branch of strange berries, its long bow trailed on a wave that broke where the sunlight paled. Red toppling balls on the white sea crest that heaved it up from the shining west, and bore it straight to my sobbing breast. The branch of strange berries sailed forth to me for the sign of land and fecundity. Shuddering, staggering as one dead, I heard them. Land. Land. Land, they said. Land, they shrieked and again they shrieked. The wallowing caravel's timbers creaked and I sank down on the deck quite dumb, for my answering miracle had come. The unbelievable land was there, it slowly loomed on the atmosphere. Oh, the dim, dark, strange, unspeakable shore, fringed out on the blue. Then I heard them roar, San Salvador! San Salvador! They tossed up their arms, they leaped on the deck. Black faces grinned through crusted fleck, bloody bearded eye and skeleton hand pointed me. Senor! Senor! Land! Water they brought in an olive wood cup, the last royal drops, to my feet they crept, and laughed and kissed me, and raved and wept, and my fame they sang, I, who had been believer in things I had not seen. Judge of me, God, that I never quailed, but that as through hell and horror we sailed, sail on. Sail on, I said. Judge of me, God, who, when I cried for sign, sent the carved stick overside, and the branch of strange berries that rode the tide. And pardon my sins, for I was, I ween, true to the country I had not seen. Then, Jesu, judge of those whose speed to those new fair shores was confident greed, now that of courage there was no need, who called me master and called me friend when the bitter doubting was at an end. Pity all men whose fate has been, they steer for a country they have not seen. From a window. On other quiet summer nights like these, I have leaned forth where honeysuckles pressed the twilight pane, and watched the priory west send forth its cowled clouds over purple seas, seeing, through eve-blurred glass, the waters rise beyond sea lavender's fringed traceries, worshipping, as I worship now, the sign that God and earth are ever one divine. Only, the flower of lily in the green, the scarlet feathered blackbird in the sedge, even the white shell by the water's edge, seem to have seen God, whom I have not seen. Yet with these wistful eyes that may not know, let me dare every doubt and darkness. So, walking blind roads, spanning all voids, I tread earth's flowing beauty to its fountainhead. Responsible. I looked over the purple fields and out to the sunlit sea, and the curve and waft of a gull's white wing was solace enough for me, and I had signals from tall green grass and the light of sand on the beach, but I heard the laughter of girls together, young and vibrant with sunlit weather, laughter of skyward reach. And hurrying by with ardent paces, I saw anticipants on their faces. Wisdom no age can teach. Youth with unconscious gleam and shining kept its eyes on a glad divining, keyed to the tall cliff reach. I saw the bloom of these girls together, bloomers of grape and peach, and they plained of the wearying wars of men, quivering. Give us our world again. Give us the youth that shall clasp us close. Give us the heart of the perfumed rose. Life is our gift while the world is young. Shall our eyes be blinded, our song unsung? Give us our destiny of yore. Do ye pour us all in your hopper of war. Only the young girls down on the beach, but out to the world their voices reach. Voices of maidens over the dune, flickering back in a windy rune. Give us our old-time destiny, our tall young mates and our babes to hold. Is life for us a tale that is told? Caught in your battle industry, shall we grow wrinkled and pale and old, pouring the lead and smoothing the bore in munition molding forevermore? Shall our slender fingers pick lint and bands for the shell-shocked eyes and the frozen hands? Shall we give our youth for the killing of men, and turn us to blood and hating again? Give us our destinies of yore, give us our homes by city and shore. Do ye pour us all in your hopper of war? Then I saw the sky in a passion of grey sweep them with fog and shut them away, and their voices seemed to die with the years, and the mist dripped round them with furtive tears, and the waves, wild foaming from tidal deep, stiffened and blanched in their curling leap. And a bird, mist baffled with heavy wing, beat on the chill air wavering. And I watched the young forms wistful go where the foggy fields stretched dun and low, and their eyes were heavy with solemn woe. While far up the beach and across the sea, the voices of youth cast a curse on me, and the ancient weed on the windblown shore bared me the barren breast of war. Tree worship. My room has great windows, clear water-like windows awash with golden sun, my books shine green and red, and the bed is white as milk, the rugs flecked like a brook, and the shelf holds a silver bowl and a candle of honey gold. But I look out of the room, away from the wine-red books, to one gaunt shagbark tree that stands playing itself like a swaying cloud-keyed harp, or writing upon the sky, with a myriad twig-keen pens. My room has a cushion, soft as sea foam on the sand, but I look out on the tree, it draws me, holds me, speaks, and does not speak, is still, dumb, yet singing and glad. And I know that I, in the room, silken and warm and soft, am as ignorant as the man who sat in a Dashan cave, clad in blood-soaked skins, gnawing at roots and nuts. A man who looked at a tree and feared it, and felt its spell, and bowed him down in awe, and sacrificed, and prayed, and was subject to the tree, thinking it might be God. Another chance. Spring's first robin perched on the apple tree. "Hello," said I. "Hello," said he. He ruffled his feathers and cocked his eye. "We're back," said he. "We're back," said I. He bit the cold buds cheerfully. "I see it's the same old you," said he. I looked him over, perched on high. "I see it's the same old you," said I. "What do you work for this year?" asked he. "The same old hopes of last year," said I. "What do you work for this year?" asked I. "The same old hopes of last year," said he. "What? After the cat and that tragedy of your whole nest blown from the apple tree. You've got the courage that takes you high. If you build again after that," said I, "well, what of your dreams that didn't come true, and the world that mocked and cheated you? You must be brave, and I do not see how you dare build again," said he. "What do ye want this year?" asked I. "A strong nest under a placid sky and your brood to cherish tenderly." "Well, you've got it about right," said he. "What do you want this year?" asked he. "An answer to all the mystery. Some haven within a faith's clear sky. Please God." "Yes, Robin, dear," said I. "Well, spring's here, anyhow," said he. "Good luck," and flew from the apple tree. "Yes, whatever the hopes that die, God gives us another spring," said I. "Dark minstrels, we heard the poets singing in the dark, we saw their lovely lights toss to and fro, the while they gathered in their golden arc all the bright images of afterglow. They struck us magic chords within the wood, showed us fair shapes alive with naked light. They gave us rivers where the dream trees brood and lovers wander all the starry night. We turned and faced each other and we said, 'The poets pour us wine, they do not give us bread. For these are singers of dear vanished things, the things that once have been but may not be.' We sit with close shut lips, you enminstreled, we. No heart to chant to these enamored strings, no song to chant to medieval lyre that strikes us songs of Nineveh and Tyre. Our lutes are tuned to dangerous unwalked ways where all is dense and beckoning shapes withdraw, where the untrodden path winds in a maze, and lead to things no seeker ever saw. We sing the mind's high dream, the imperious will, that makes no music out of greedy strife but seizes silver pipes, that sharp and shrill, call men to leap and seize on very life. While other singers tell the old dreams o'er, we rise and take us to the outer door, here on the world, where no wise singer sings, we feel the great hand brush across our strings. The people of today to the clergy of today. Look now about you, fix your eyes on us, leave two old mystic book and restful chair, take up our problems, things we must discuss, help us to think, to understand and dare. Leave old world poetry of hallowed crime and turn you to the hunger of the time. Laws of the God, report them to the ears that hear confused and cosmic voices rage. Laws of the Christ, interpret them to fears for Christ, new risen in a science age. Oh, take the fire your sacred hands should give and kindle it upon our city height. Give us a world strong law of wrong and right. Teach us, not how to die, but how to live. The hymns we sing must be the song of spheres. The prayers we pray be truths of stone and star. We want no sacrifice of sinners' tears. We want to rise above this clay we are. Our war machines, Do they not teach the thing your maxims never taught us? Ah, we flee to the waste places in our sorrowing. Show us the power of true divinity. Look now around you, free your two white hands, comfort these hearts that burn. What must we do? We have no Paul, no Moses, only you. Then help us to be honest. From all lands, priests, men, arise. Acclaim. The new bread give, the bread by which we shall not die, but live. Protagonist. The fight was unequal, bitter and always new. I saw how my enemy gained on me and how he drew my strength, my youth, my soul from my shivering frame. Yet have I not been beaten, I faced him whenever he came. When he stabbed I watched how he did it. Poison, I studied the cup, flayed me with whips, I girded the bleedings up. Hunger, imprisonment, all these I wrote in my book. I have learned all the enemy's purpose, I know every look. I have conned every gesture and gotten by heart all his guile, yet still comes the fear and the watchfulness under my smile, for hard as I struggle to outwit his plot to betray me, he holds that utterest thing that can utterly slay me, still do I turn and defy the face of him creeping, now that I know thee. Thou life, thou art locked in my keeping, dungeoned, thou horror, in creative cells of desire, ringed in the widening rings of my aspirant fire, I, your creator, by steady implacable strife, shall give men and women a lovelier thing to call life. Signal fires. Everywhere we have sought thee, questioned, wondered, everywhere marked thy beauty and thine hour. Now if at last no sacrifice is brought thee, dost thou believe we doubt thine awful power? Nay, we have loved, have striven, have served, obeyed thee, gloried in beauty of thine, uttered thy love, given long vigils to attain and mind thee, spent lives in fixing thee below, above. Still dost withhold thee, canst ignore this wonder of men who seek thee in the manner thou knowest. Humble and longing, ignorant, who blunder, yet loyal to thy will and where thou goest. We will not cowardly say thou'st no feeling, will not believe thou hidest back of the years, or'st no word for rapturous revealing, art dumb like us, art veiled in tears. No. We believe, but now we work nor tire stirring the embers of the cosmic night. Thou art the source, we build our answering fire, God of our godhood, answer our beacon light. Martyr. He waved his jests on spears of hidden grief, calmed by his silence all complaint and tears. Filled hopeless hours with whimsical belief, and laughed at fears. He walked his bitter paths alert and bold, no pity ever turned his steadfast eye, if dull mouths grinned and goblin stories told, he cared not why. And with what end? To end a dream of breath, singing his heart out to all withheld joy, walking into the labyrinth of death, brave as a boy. Ballad of the Thorn Tree. Always, I noticed, lovers lay beneath a twisted tree that grew in such a starved way it seemed a mock to me. But when I questioned them, they'd say, oh, what is that to thee? Bright berries grow in lavish way upon this bitter tree. Small scarlet lanterns swinging, they for lovers such as we. Always I noticed lovers dreamed beneath that furtive tree, and so I said not how it seemed nor how it looked to me. How all along the branches ran sharp thorns like stabbing spears, how when the berries dropped away the thorns stayed through the years. Oh, never do I speak of this to lovers loving free, the new fruit gleams above their kiss, the thorns they will not see. Mayhap after such glowing red no thorn keeps agony, but no fond lover e'er has said a thing like this to me. Balloons on the beach. Ball on bright ball, on the sky glowing, the old dreams recall of a child's knowing, eggs laid by a flying bird, jellies in globed curd, fruits on a strange tree, by the winds blowing. Now as each bobbing ball tugs at its holder, I, who these dreams recall, feel hardly older. Drinking enchanted cup from balloons, I rise up, swaying on sea and sky, color and flight am I. Appled balloon tree, arched efflorescence, grow shining globes for me, of joyous essence, until bright bubbles spill from a cup fancies fill brimmed iridescence. They pass. Down the long road they go, Eleanor, Mary, Flo, hasting toward something. Daisies rank high today, wild roses spread the way, laughing, light words, they say, speeding toward something. Peg, on the other side, watches their splendid stride, shrinking from something. Jenny, with broken tread, where a damp sun is shed, black shawl around her head, staggers from something. On the beach. She sat in her gleaming robes with the two hard shining globes of her soulless eyes, stare fixed, and said, it is mine to know how far he may come and go, mine to make him dance and sing, his heart and his money fling away. He is mine to take, and play with and bend and break, the better for him I think. We are put here to try each other. Is he strong? He will not sink. The other woman pulled the thin shawl over her head. If he is strong, she murmured, if he is strong you said. But are we strong? It is ours to spare, to shield, to tend, it is his to be hurt and broken, to struggle and to fend. It is equal, therefore we suffer. He suffers most, I think. We are put here to help each other. Are we strong? He will not sink. Saul's Hills. One long after all the talking people go on the white boat that rounds the sandy point, the silenced hollows of the commons show a deepening curve, and where the grasses blow, dried to October wraith, I see anoint a hundred lanes and valleys splashed with glints of silver moss and tawny tapered mints. To and where the moor roads plough the tangled sand, the sky's blue river floods these merging hills, Pocomo Head white morning fire spills, the deep swung ponds with sapphire sweep expand walled with red berries of the alder bough, stark monkish trees slant on the windblown space, and gulls dip to the bay or open meadow place. Three, this is a world gone wild with wine of life, tossed in bright cups on frost and holid air, here autumn swings the west wind's winnowing scythe, or amber shod strays down the coral flare. And on the shimmering slopes the swallows blithe still turn ecstatic honey-tipped wings and dart anew on rhythmic balancings. For I think that he who walks this undulance goes like a child back to some crystal source, rich in adventures of the field's romance, the thistle's aeroplane, the gold of gorse, or buoyant, treading silver lichen crisp wing-footed on the elastic sod, fares on the milkweed's fundethral wisp past semaphore of broom or golden rod. 5-4 Here he finds the ineffable escape, the clarity, the cleanness and the soul, here's laying on of hands, here things reshape into the round equilibrated whole. Here all is light and line, this grey fence strings its silver loops in limpid meadow lights, or drops its bars to infinite wanderings by glimmering swamps on break-illumined nights. 6 So suave these moor roads that the grasses blur along their misty lines, their curious curves unwind through dusks of bay and juniper past where the marsh hawk flares or rabbit swerves, where pond on mirroring pond among the hills is cupped in vital blue, whose magnet draws spiked pickerel weed, or starred sabbatia thrills grass-threaded ripples on the sandy shores. 7 So dumb are human hearts to every sound that nature has strangely attuned, dumb still. There is no keynote to their most profound, no language for true passion of their will, yet in these valleys on these sun-pooled moors, where turf roads wind to fountains of the sky, I have seen souls freed by the out-of-doors, to find out here their liberate ecstasy. 8 Perhaps these gemmy berries on the slope, perhaps these dryads of the circling hedge write runes of health and happiness and hope, or limn new truth in sand and rippled sedge. For those who tread these wastes of autumn's reach find dream and vision on the wind-washed lea, thoughts broaden, there is fire in the speech, minds stir beyond their wonted sophistry. 9 It is the other self, the questing ghost that walks with us the bayberry's pungent trail, seeing this life an empty thing, at most, seeing dreams die and all beliefs grow pale. Musing on hopes and visions, scattered hosts, till here, beside some mossy lichen rail, the sky seems light with truth and starving minds, bathed in new energy of moorland winds. 10 The rosaries here are little mealy plums trailing like rubies through the tufted moss, here a late bee to evening primrose comes. The field's grey-wreathed smoky censers toss, where goldenrod has burned from gold to grey, and asters smoke on an empurpled way. 11 Turfed roads that curve away to Madake, dim roads that wind the valleys to Gibbs Pond, grass roads that dream to Pulpis, we have yet to find your subtle ends, what lies beyond. You wind to wind the world, the simple ways of faith and trust and nobleness and love, we only guess the towers beyond your haze. We only glimpse the ends toward which you move. 12 Yet rutted roads, whose mild evasions lie seemingly blind or tortuous or dense, ye are most human in your subtlety, human in all your gentle evidence. For though you pause and double, turn again and seem to curve and hesitate, your moods are human moods. Tired women and worn men follow in dream your errant solitudes. 13 They come for shriving by the hedgerow things where life, obedient to great moving laws brilliantly dies, or in birth scatterings writes mystical trail with myriad seeds and spores, where the dried weeds with hoary tresses blown quiver in brittle faith and stand serene. Where in a tidal sunshine, every cone smells of sea tree branch, balsam broomed and clean. 14 Solitude on the moors and to one's self. The blessing comes in spite of torturings, in spite of all the gods upon the shelf and all the false gods of material things. Here where the thistle sends its wayward floss or where the marsh hawk swirls for meadow food, alone on cloistered roads redeem thy loss of spirit, in a bay-bushed solitude. 15. O, spirit of ours, whom we have so betrayed, as round these swimming hills our footsteps dream, we see thy fugitive shimmer on the blade of every spear of grass, and by the gleam of sea light out at Pocomo and glade of twisted beach by rambling Pulpis farm, or by the reedy pool where cattle strayed far from the fields stir up the midgy swarm. 16. Where all the rolling hillsides soft combine on amphitheatres spread to open clefts, there is hypnotic soothing in the line merging and melting in soft grassy wefts. The brave bright cups that grail the open mead pour flower libation on some tawny stretch, and lily grail snowy processions lead, and sweet fern banners guide the banded vetch. 17. And what does man? He takes a wealth like this and breaks it on the wheel of his machine, tarring it with the foul metropolis, caging its wildness and its free desmisson. Little they know they build but to destroy, little they guess what gift they take away, the heritage of every girl and boy to roam these stretches of the heath and bay. 18. The exquisite clear candors of these moors seem to their eyes as sad as empty doom. Their trivial gaze turns from the barren shores and blurs along the ragged hills of broom. They pant, they say, for human nature's food, yes, but they have not walked with happy solitude. 19. Grey rain slow drifting over summer hill, over corn fields and through the meadow rifts, with falling curtain calms the water till under its scorcery the landscape drifts, the loomed mirage goes sailing to the sky, the deep lines darken on the distant moors, a placid silence lifts in mystery, and headlands purple down to light-struck shores. 20. Then open farm a sterner grandeur takes. The church dome glitters on fantastic north. The wild duck's chain expansion suddenly breaks, and many a wedge-shaped line of geese fares forth. Fateful the moorland looks and tawny drear, then the clouds lift and all the islands clear. 21. O truth, that moves upon the water's face. O truth, that cleaves the fire and cloud to be. Help me with single eye thy form to trace, in every form of flower and web and tree, help me to find thee in the cause of waves, in every face that dreams into my ken, help me to see thee in the man that braves the condemnation of his fellow men. O shining truth, sweeping across these fields, calm on the water's surface, or in storm, help me to find thee in the harvest yields, in cloistered rooms and in the market's swarm. Help me to find thee in the name of sin, the immortal shape of woe that walks alone, help me to hear thy subtle lesson in the negative, the dirge, the monotone. Help me to know thee in the sturdy mind that holds its vision straight across the dark, that dares to blaze a trail for all mankind yet wins no high serene nor earthly mark. Help me to find thee behind solemn doors where men declare for finer, nobler codes, help me to find thee on the rainy moors, and on the wanderings of these rutted roads. 22. The days are warm all Indian summer through, placid and mild with dreaming full content, beech plums and grapes glimmer with frosty dew, rabbits career from hunter provident, mellow and hazy blurs the moorland scene, placid and still on dreamy tides of noon. The fishing fleet comes silver-laden in, and over haystacks floats the harvest moon. 23 Horizoned moon, so round and thin and strange, great mellow bowl of gold September brew, diaphanous rolling over rolling range of solemn hills that part to let thee through. The last great toy of summer, yellow boon, all honey-filled, lambent with creamy light, hardly a gazer of us but will croon some childish nonsense to thy disk tonight. 24 Upon a night of stars, the grave old mill spreads out its fans upon a scudding sky, the crescent harbor's ebony is still, studded with plangent lights trailed silvery. Here is true self, once more with hand on lip, trying to read the night's deep graven lines, watching the shadow of some late come ship, or muffling darkness of the blotted pines. 25 The summer streets are filled with flickering swarms. The village band is playing and the wheels of farmer wagons clatter past the farms. Bright headlights of black bulking automobiles flit back of Monomoy, where Indians, now pressing the clover with accustomed heels, would find great modern monsters on their track beside their wigwam or beyond their shack. 26 But as the music filters through the town, and honeysuckle breathes around the doors, one finds the lane as secret as the shores, no modern engine treads its sweetness down. No smart prospector makes this isle his own, for pattern of the cheap and opportune, not neath this honeysuckle and this moon. 27 Back of the town where all the houses turn their mild grey fronts to winds that buffet strong, the cobbled streets in patterns quaint and stern, lead to four trees spread on the sky like song, looking at these I paused the other day. Wondering that beauty so bestripped, forlorn, should strike a chord that takes processional way, crashed on the skies in branches gaunt and worn. 28 Twisted and starved these bitter trees that blow upon the western sky like choral song, flinging strange rapture on the afterglow, still radiant. Do these dead trees belong to some tree part of us, where bent and maimed green branches wither? Hampered twigs grow wrong. Hush! On the screen of the bright western sky the crippled trees again burst into song. 29 Modest these little houses of the town, staring with sober windows over the lea. Scattered are peaks and gables toward the down, trailing slow march from seaport to the sea. Charmed thing to hear one's footfall sound along some moonlit, bricked, hedged street, whose panelled doors gleam with bright knockers, where the oblivioned stone was trodden once by Quaker ancestors. 30 The minstered vast of immemorial sea. Blue vaults and green that cave the island tide's choruses solemn dark immensity to that moon priest that with its lore abides. The hooded waves march on cathedral dunes, flagellant spring the breakers on the rips, and the encircling shore is writ with runes of voyaging souls and questing sails and ships. Yeah. All around cathedral vast of sea blue vaults and green that cave the island's tides curled toppling unshells of eternity illumining the beach's glistening sides, new consecrate the sand's communion shell with every moonlight chrism and sunrise swell. Clean island, cloistered ways unspoiled by man, the thorn trees cloaked like prophets, and the reed's organ with murmurings of furtive Pan, the spirit's intense strange music, lost from creeds, lost far from love, lost in all modern places, lost from the reading by all human faces, isolate, dumb, but if one wanders here, vocal and strong, immaculate and clear. For now one figure left of all the gods goes singing down the thistle-lighted way, one figure wanders through these island moods back from the town and back of all the bay. And where the golden rods their senses sway against a break or by a grey swamp wood, over the moor steals happy solitude. 31 The corn is stacked, the pumpkins on the roof, globule on grey their ponderous green and gold, the laughing gull wantons its wild reproof, the water's blue is strangely laced with cold, vermilion berries coral the black-hedged pond, around the shore the chilly foam patch quivers, the sweet fern shrivels up its copper frond, the owl flaps heavily, the farmland shivers. 32 These are the roads the island farmers took, slow following flocks that tinkled towards the town, and stopped to crop the clover or to look with horned stare across the purple down. These are the roads the shearers of the sheep in high-swung wagons rode, these winding trails moccasins knew, where now the children keep to shim o'shore with huckleberry pails. 33 What is the thing that on these commons gives me back to me? What is this thing that heals the city's wounds, that shows to me where lives the being of me? What sorcery reveals my hidden native, blind, unnamed, unsung, wrapped in its passion at our doors like a shape of chambered chrysalid soul, close woofed, high swung, waiting for sun and rain and winged escape. 34 There are wild days out on the winter heath, wild days as smoke in mystery and flame, the black ducks break their columns into wreath, the gaunt trees cringe away in windblown shame, the moody skies press to the barren earth, sullen the sea hangs foam around the shore, there is a look of starving and of dearth along the shivering roads across the moor. 35 Then, as if space awed of its yawning breach desired rhythms to sound some message home, crash in great clouds, dark waves of earthy speech, the farmland's seaweed pile and stubbled loam. There is cloud writing on the scrolled west, the church's dome swells symboled on the sky, austere the landscape, yet so clear expressed, it looms to awe and brooding majesty. 36 And then on headland or on barren dune, the wild light leaps, born of the naked sea, the north cliffs are cathedral. There is rune and choral in the surf's antiphony. The labourer, who slowly takes his way back to the hamlet in the early night, sees the old village set in convent grey, and candled shrines of votive window light. 37 There are great days in autumn, when the world turns to blue fire and all the hills are red. One hears the fishing gull's wild screaming skirled up to the winged cumrids overhead. The sound is flecked with scudding green and white, and beaches stretch away to golden glow, till stars hang garlanded along the night, and constellations swing liquid and low. 38 And foggy days, when wrapped in trailing pause, the trees, like ships, sail pearly seas bemused with melting sails and ropes of rainy gauze making for harbour, tenuous, confused, anchored in subtle inlets, phantom cruised, where voyagers land unchallenged, unperused, with silver myrrh to sanctify the homes, and cloudy swirls to hallow forth the domes. 39 These ships bring stores by which my heart is fed. The voyages of this filmy vapor flight lay balm on gashes where the soul has bled, wrapping its wounds in meshes of soft light. And I am soothed of grief, who take a white communion under calm of dripping trees, walking uncandled avenues of rainy night with veiled forms to nebulous mysteries. 40 Charmed thing to drift along the narrow lanes where some dear door flies open to the rap, to sit behind windows of wailing days, a lantern in the hall, a chair mayhap some geniest folger used, to read a log stamped with inked whales, kept blue from boyhood cruise, the swift that wound the yarn, peat from the bog, the horn the town crier used to cry the news. 41 Charmed thing to catch a sea word full of spice, to eat of beach plum jelly by the fire, to see rag rugs hooked like a sailor's splice, to watch the peat's blue flicker on the fire, to see the rafters carved in sailor ways, paintings of canvased ships crossing the bars, when daring whalers went uncharted ways, and laid their course by youth's adventurous stars. 42 Along the street in early morning's glow, down to their boats the Portuguese fishers go, and through the cobbled alleys booted feet drown the gruff voice as sailors' comrades meet. Then shawled forms slip down to the baker's shop, the Spanish bell rings in the tower top, the placid tradesmen wait the lifted latch, and quarrog diggers launch for the clamming patch. 43 But village stir and village matters keep Freemasonry too subtle and too deep for strangers' smattering tongue and half-taught eye that sees them through a garbled mystery. What shall be known of souls that live and love, marry and bear, no joy and agony, under blue circle of an island sky within the silver ring of sounding sea? 44 Their quiet dreams take root in resolute ways, their poetry is blown to spurts of flame, from their grim grandeur of forgotten days comes many a high and sober-minded name. Their character persists where many a door opened its narrow pride to let them roam, their feet stand firm on an unshaken floor, roofed by great roof trees of New England home. 45 So to the memory their great names come what time they reckoned life and grasped its fact, their splendid hours when their spirits dumb, unworded promise became conscious act. The islanders, Nantucketers, their theme endures in a worth that cannot fail. Across the country their progressive dream steadily marks the great New England trail. 46 For even now in times of want and war, in times of apathy and greed and fear, the challenges to spirit skyward soar, the core of stalwart things is hidden here. The white shoals lift like new creative shore, the sound's salt breath comes like a stirrup cup, till every wanderer takes his burden up. 47 So, with it all remote, tranquil, unchanged, untouched in depths of solitude and peace, the island fades away, the shoals are ranged, backward in sliding rank the bluffs decrease, backward they slide, the glittering sound spreads wide. Now is no road to island paths but foam, a long, long water path twixt us and home. 48 Yet when we sit in silence at the board and shapen silver glitters on the white damask, bubbled with flower and glass and scored with sensuous patterns of the candlelight, one smiles and speaks of sconset lighthouse flare, of sails like wings tapered upon the sound, of tossing cross-rip by the bellboy, where the schooners get their ranges outward bound. 49 There falls a silence until someone tells an old wife's tale, another speaks of bay, another one of Canterbury bells, and someone else of meadows stacked with hay. The kindling smile goes round, the voices muse, the light is kind that travels from eye to eye, and many lonely island trampings fuse, along rut roads go many a memory. 50 With eyes alight we say, when shall I go where the blue chicory twinkles toward the town, or bouncing bet bathes in a rosy snow, or where the night wafts scent across the down, when shall I breathe the breath of inshore spins, and see the darkling fern of water floors, and catch the drive of myriad mackerel fins where the furred trawler floats its netted jaws. 51 In spite of foppish talk and city form, we take the lane and loiter on the crest, speaking in terms of island sun and storm, the marlin's tarry smell, the breaker's breast, until across the light and baffling word there steals the old sea wind, and with a thrill the stagnant pools of city minds are stirred, incoming tides the vapid channels fill. 52 But we, who know, speak in no idle way, we hold no rendezvous, nor name an hour, we make no promise when to go or stay, we do not plan to gather fruit or flower, we only tell the image deep within our struggling beings, beyond all abodes and all the challenging, whether we lose or win, spirit, we too shall take the island roads. Sea measure. All night long the even roll of sea rhythmic and slow on silence to whose inner mystery no man may go. Socrates, Plato, Christ must all have heard walking the lonely beach listening for that hidden inner word that they might teach. All lonely men the centuries sent down to master human things must have been strengthened by this monotone to even a ponderings. Quietly feeling what we feel tonight that there is hidden bond between our deep selves and some infinite deepness beyond. In an old burying ground. This is strange heraldry the graveyard paints for him who best perceives its curious feints. Under its leaning stones sailors and parson men titles and beggarman maidens and crones mingle their bones. They laugh at dreams we weave of equality under the sun yet here it's done. Under the frail grass spear all these are equal here none lie alone. Greek name and Bible name pagan and prude, under the grass not any class. Fine old aristocrat, right near his trim kept plaid the cobbler's lass. Also I notice near sun shining full and clear violets as blue. The man who used to swear sleeping quite calmly there where Quakers do. Dreamer and prig and crank, humble and full of swank level they rank to us they all seem just handfuls of human dust even and blank. And this I've come to hold one may be quite an old aristocrat, but when one comes to die things are democracy and that is that. Christmas Eve on Nantucket. For half an hour tonight we wander through the streets, and see the Christmas trees against the lighted pane, and catch child voices raised in glee and hear street singers chanting carols loud and free then a bell tone, and then the far-off sea. We turn a corner and we pass a house whence strains of music come. Minute Cretans, they will be singing that in Paris tonight. From a side gate a scarlet figure booted, slips with bells jingling, some amateur Santa Claus late for festival. Here a bright-voiced smiling woman hurries along to the dim-lighted church, bearing a hemlock wreath made by her hands. Upon white paneled doors hang other wreaths woven from ground pine near Wanakome Pond. And scarlet berries blaze in window boxes bare of summer flowers but now made holiday. Another narrow street, and here the candles shine ranging along the pane in a white row, lovely immaculates of memory. And in another window a small figure, a dainty mandarin poised in chinoy's grace beneath some mistletoe. And in one window more an old white head is bent over some early coming gift brought by the letter carrier from children far away. Late. Yet a few steps further, where the narrow lane turns to the moors. There in December skies tender with Christmas memories of years on years, hangs in its winter white, the evening star. Song of the lightships. Landlubber's chanty. When the wolves of wind press hard on the wild sea's snarling pack, and the waves bite the shore and the shore bites back. When the night's like a cave full of black things howling and the hurricanes rave with the whistle boy yowling. There's a rusty trusty boat that never makes a port. There's a scrubby bold boat that never finds a lee. The blunt little lightship. The ironclad lightship. The weatherwise lightship, anchored out at sea. When the storm signals set. Great point stuck with masts, and the range lights blur through the wicked black blasts when the extra anchors drag and the bellboy clangs and the jetty rocks swirl under tide rips fangs. There's one little boat that never makes a port, there's one tidy ship that never seeks a lee, the blunt little lightship, the staunch, able lightship, the game. Snubby lightship anchored out at sea. When the night's very still and the moon rides high, there's one strange craft gives a hail and stands by. Though the forms on her decks have a look of the dead, still they warn of a wreck or a shoal dead ahead. It's the winter-lost lightship that never found a lee. It's the tide-driven lightship that never made a port. It's the silent crude lightship, the speechless brave lightship, the ice-covered lightship sunk at sea. Now when home fires blaze and the storm is shut out, and the wind and its ways are sea yawned about, when the good glass is lifted in the good pipe smoke and the good talk has drifted from the well-worn joke. Toast the one little boat that never makes port. Sing of the craft that never hunts a lee. Drink to the lightships, the lonely crews of lightships, the lunging, plunging lightships anchored out at sea. September noon. Upon the warm brick walls the patterns come, dim moving likenesses of pensive leaves. The swallows twitter round the ivied eaves, late bees in perilous petunias hum, on the moors, amber grape and bloomy plum. But here in trim backyards the apple's face twinkling with dahlias in some latticed place. The stranger's foot has gone and all the world has settled down to island ways of peace, where the clouds' midsummer caravan sees soundlessness on the hills is silver-furled. Now all faint scents and spice of full increase. The scarlet pepper pendant on its bush and late corn leaning on the farmland hush. Slow wagons trundle with the seagrass haul. The crickets, palaced in the goldenrod, begin their strumming. The horse chestnuts fall and morning glories on the trellis nod. Marigold's velvet turns to pungent pod. A sea of azure girds the shores around. The tawny silence mellows till the deep steamboat whistle's somber-throated sound wakens the owl from Indian summer's sleep. Then all is bustle and the city's stir once more has come upon the islander. Main Street by moonlight. The old church clock strikes one, and down the row of ancient houses where the moonlight floods, the black tree branches move like wands that throw a net of woven loopings flecked with buds. The night is still, a silver quiet now transforms the plain old homes whose ancient mood returns. Through paneled doorways come and go figures soft-shod, in prim calash and hood. Here by a lilac bush the little gate supports two figures of sweetheart and beau. Here by a hedge two others hesitate, then join the shadowy thronging to and fro. Do you believe that in those rooms upstairs the newer generation dreams again back to the lives of all these women and men, setting them free to haunt the pavements here? That youngsters sleeping see sails homeward fair, ships laden with treasure and salt romance, the Quakers broad brim, Puritans askance. That such bold dreaming sets these spirits free on this deserted street in moonlit beam, coming alive though coming soberly and looking on us as figures in their dream. Hush! With what proud simplicity these figures move and live again, austerities of grace who used their lives so guardedly, this glove the homespun petticoat, this barb of lace, boots and prunellus on the brick path pace, fair tinted skin, clear eye and honored name come through the paneled doors or garden place. The scholar's reserve, the solid merchant's fame, the friends, the captains, blooded knight and dame, who to old English gentry backward trace. So through the cobbled streets they silently press on very gentle errands of their own and make no plea, and no proud tale confess, nor look aghast at their once simple town, yet do they smile, permitting us to guess that they prefer their own to our renown. Was that the clock just struck? The street is clear, the moon rides high, there are no figures here. Someone stopped dreaming in this street, my dear. Psalm of imagined hunger. If I were starving in Nantucket, I would first go down to the beach and dig for quahogs, or some scallops, or drop overboard a neat little lobster car, or row to a place where there are wild oysters, then I would hang around the docks at 5 o'clock when the fishermen come in, and perhaps get an extra place fish or some shark or black fish, though I shouldn't like to eat horseshoe crab or squid. That failing, I would go out on the moors and snare a pheasant, I would catch a rabbit, and though I wouldn't know how to cook it, an owl. To eat crow, I have heard, is not judicious, but how about marsh hawk? If it were August, I would get Irish moss out of the sea, and flavor it with cranberries. I would then go crabbing near our island home. If it were July, I should live in the blueberry patches and find blackberries, you know where, and get strawberries in the old cemetery. I would go mushrooming, very prudently, in fields near thorn lots. I would go beach plumbing, very early, on the state road. I would get in touch with grape vines near Warwine and with hazelnuts near Sconset, and dig for swamp root out near Madake. Elderberry would be a last resort. I would hang over the fences of a certain yard in Hussey Street to see if grapes and pears would come to me. Or I would interrupt tea parties on Pleasant Street, boldly walking in and asking for apples. Of course I would weed the potato patch of anyone that asked me to for two potatoes. I would help with the melons and do what I could for corn and pumpkins. Peaches and cherries I would pluck on shares, but if all these things failed I would go to a little house, where they always know what I mean and ask for food. The Moon Canoe. Where evening tides creep dark and blue, I launch my little moon canoe. I leave the planet harbor light, and lay my course along the night. I paddle down the Milky Way where phosphor sky weeds gleam and spray, and pluck what starry branches grow along its winding overflow. I swing my shallop out mid-dream where tides of summer evening stream, and carried on this sound so wide, still on and on and on I glide, harking, along the western bar the bellboy of a swinging star. My meteor anchor will, I ween, hold in this dark of depth unseen. The dew, my silver lead and line doth sound me shallows of starshine, and now and then I reef the veil of fog that serves me for a sail. When, bold, I make the western lee, old pilot's shadows signal me, and tacking windward come a fleet of clouds, with ghostly spar and sheet. I follow them and disembark, and moor my boat beyond the dark. Deprecation. While mending nets I made the songs I knew, hummed them for sake of humming, not for singing. But as I crooned, the bellboy crooned them too. The blacksmith had them on his anvil ringing, and the gulls carried them on clear-cut winging. Yet, if their ragged form the world regrets, do you explain? But, she was mending nets. Asterisk 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 end of the project Gutenberg ebook Nantucket Windows asterisk 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 updated editions will replace the previous one, the old editions will be renamed. Creating the works from print editions not protected by U.S. copyright law means that no one owns a United States copyright in these works. So the Foundation, and you, can copy and distribute it in the United States without permission and without paying copyright royalties. Special rules, set forth in the general terms of use part of this license, apply to copying and distributing Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works to protect the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol concept and trademark. Project Gutenberg is a registered trademark, and may not be used if you charge for an ebook, except by following the terms of the trademark license, including paying royalties for use of the Project Gutenberg trademark. If you do not charge anything for copies of this ebook, complying with the trademark license is very easy. You may use this ebook for nearly any purpose such as creation of derivative works, reports, performances and research. Project Gutenberg ebooks may be modified and printed and given away. You may do practically anything in the United States with ebooks not protected by U.S. copyright law. Redistribution is subject to the trademark license, especially commercial redistribution. Start. Full license the full Project Gutenberg license. Please read this before you distribute or use this work to protect the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol mission of promoting the free distribution of electronic works, by using or distributing this work, or any other work associated in any way with the phrase Project Gutenberg. you agree to comply with all the terms of the full Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license available with this file or online at www.gutenberg.org/license. Section 1. General Terms of Use and Redistributing Project Gutenberg Trademark Symbol Electronic Works 1.A. By reading or using any part of this Project Gutenberg Trademark Symbol Electronic Work, you indicate that you have read, understand, agree to and accept all the terms of this license and intellectual property. Trademark/copyright agreement. If you do not agree to abide by all the terms of this agreement, you must cease using and return or destroy all copies of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works in your possession. If you paid a fee for obtaining a copy of or access to a Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic work and you do not agree to be bound by the terms of this agreement, you may obtain a refund from the person or entity to whom you paid the fee as set forth in paragraph 1.E.8. 1.B Project Gutenberg is a registered trademark. It may only be used on or associated in any way with an electronic work by people who agree to be bound by the terms of this agreement. There are a few things that you can do with most Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works even without complying with the full terms of this agreement. See paragraph 1.C below. There are a lot of things you can do with Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works if you follow the terms of this agreement and help preserve free future access to Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works. See paragraph 1.E below. 1.C. The Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation. The Foundation or PGLAF owns a compilation copyright in the collection of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works. Nearly all the individual works in the collection are in the public domain in the United States. If an individual work is unprotected by copyright law in the United States and you are located in the United States, we do not claim a right to prevent you from copying, distributing, performing, displaying or creating derivative works based on the work as long as all references to Project Gutenberg are removed. Of course, we hope that you will support the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol mission of promoting free access to electronic works by freely sharing Project Gutenberg trademark symbol works in compliance with the terms of this agreement for keeping the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol name associated with the work. You can easily comply with the terms of this agreement by keeping this work in the same format with its attached full Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license when you share it without charge with others. 1.D. The copyright laws of the place where you are located also govern what you can do with this work. Copyright laws in most countries are in a constant state of change. If you are outside the United States, check the laws of your country in addition to the terms of this agreement before downloading, copying, displaying, performing, distributing or creating derivative works based on this work or any other Project Gutenberg trademark symbol work. The Foundation makes no representations concerning the copyright status of any work in any country other than the United States. 1. Unless you have removed all references to Project Gutenberg, 1.E.1. The following sentence, with active links to, or other immediate access to, the full Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license must appear prominently whenever any copy of a Project Gutenberg trademark symbol work, any work on which the phrase Project Gutenberg appears, or with which the phrase Project Gutenberg is associated, is accessed, displayed, performed, viewed, copied or distributed. This ebook is for the use of anyone anywhere in the United States and most other parts of the world at no cost and with almost no restrictions whatsoever. You may copy it, give it away or reuse it under the terms of the Project Gutenberg license included with this ebook or online at www.gutenberg.org. If you are not located in the United States, you will have to check the laws of the country where you are located before using this ebook. 1.E.2. If an individual Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic work is derived from texts not protected by U.S. copyright law, does not contain a notice indicating that it is posted with permission of the copyright holder, the work can be copied and distributed to anyone in the United States without paying any fees or charges. If you are redistributing or providing access to a work with the phrase Project Gutenberg associated with or appearing on the work, you must comply either with the requirements of paragraphs 1.E.1 through 1.E.7 or obtain permission for the use of the work and the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol trademark as set forth in paragraphs 1.E.8 or 1.E.9. 1.E.3. If an individual Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic work is posted with the permission of the copyright holder, your use and distribution must comply with both paragraphs 1.E.1 through 1.E.7 and any additional terms imposed by the copyright holder. Additional terms will be linked to the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license for all works posted with the permission of the copyright holder found at the beginning of this work. 1.E.4. Do not unlink or detach or remove the full Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license terms from this work, or any files containing a part of this work or any other work associated with Project Gutenberg trademark symbol. 1.E.5. Do not copy, display, perform, distribute or redistribute this electronic work, or any part of this electronic work, without prominently displaying the sentence set forth in paragraph 1.E.1 with active links or immediate access to the full terms of the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license. 1.E.6. You may convert to and distribute this work in any binary, compressed, marked up, non-proprietary or proprietary form, including any word processing or hypertext form. However, if you provide access to or distribute copies of a Project Gutenberg trademark symbol work in a format other than plain vanilla ASCII or other format used in the official version posted on the official Project Gutenberg trademark symbol website, www.gutenberg.org, you must, at no additional cost, fee or expense to the user, provide a copy, a means of exporting a copy, or a means of obtaining a copy upon request of the work in its original plain vanilla ASCII or other form. Any alternate format must include the full Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license as specified in paragraph 1.E.1. 1.E.7. Do not charge a fee for access to, viewing, displaying, performing, copying or distributing any Project Gutenberg trademark symbol works unless you comply with paragraph 1.E.8 or 1.E.9. 1.E.8. You may charge a reasonable fee for copies of or providing access to or distributing Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works provided that you pay a royalty fee of 20% of the gross profits you derive from the use of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol works calculated using the method you already use to calculate your applicable taxes. The fee is owed to the owner of the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol trademark, but he has agreed to donate royalties under this paragraph to the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation. Royalty payments must be paid within 60 days following each date on which you prepare, or are legally required to prepare, your periodic tax returns. Royalty payments should be clearly marked as such and sent to the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation at the address specified in Section 4. Information about donations to the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation. You provide a full refund of any money paid by a user who notifies you in writing, or by email, within 30 days of receipt that he does not agree to the terms of the full Project Gutenberg trademark symbol license. You must require such a user to return or destroy all copies of the works possessed in a physical medium and discontinue all use of and all access to other copies of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol works. You provide, in accordance with paragraph 1.F.3, a full refund of any money paid for a work or a replacement copy, if a defect in the electronic work is discovered and reported to you within 90 days of receipt of the work. You comply with all other terms of this agreement for free distribution of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol works. 1.E.9. If you wish to charge a fee or distribute a Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic work or group of works on different terms than are set forth in this agreement, you must obtain permission in writing from the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation, the manager of the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol trademark. Contact the foundation as set forth in Section 3 below. 1.F.1.F.1. Project Gutenberg volunteers and employees expend considerable effort to identify, do copyright research on, transcribe and proofread works not protected by U.S. copyright law in creating the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol collection. Despite these efforts, Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works, and the medium on which they may be stored, may contain defects such as, but not limited to, incomplete, inaccurate or corrupt data, transcription errors, a copyright or other intellectual property infringement, a defective or damaged disk or other medium, a computer virus, or computer codes that damage or cannot be read by your equipment. 1.F.2. limited warranty, disclaimer of damages, except for the right of replacement or refund described in paragraph 1.f.3. The Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation, the owner of the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol trademark, and any other party distributing a Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic work under this agreement, disclaim all liability to you for damages, costs and expenses, including legal fees. You agree that you have no remedies for negligence, strict liability, breach of warranty or breach of contract except those provided in paragraph 1.f.3. You agree that the foundation, the trademark owner, and any distributor under this agreement will not be liable to you for actual, direct, indirect, consequential, punitive or incidental damages even if you give notice of the possibility of such damage. 1.f.3. Limited right of replacement or refund. If you discover a defect in this electronic work within 90 days of receiving it, you can receive a refund of the money, if any, you paid for it by sending a written explanation to the person you received the work from. If you received the work on a physical medium, you must return the medium with your written explanation. The person or entity that provided you with the defective work may elect to provide a replacement copy in lieu of a refund. If you received the work electronically, the person or entity providing it to you may choose to give you a second opportunity to receive the work electronically in lieu of a refund. If the second copy is also defective, you may demand a refund in writing without further opportunities to fix the problem. 1.f.4. Except for the limited right of replacement or refund set forth in paragraph 1.f.3, this work is provided to you as is, with no other warranties of any kind, express or implied, including but not limited to warranties of merchantability or fitness for any purpose. 1.f.5. Some states do not allow disclaimers of certain implied warranties or the exclusion or limitation of certain types of damages. If any disclaimer or limitation set forth in this agreement violates the law of the state applicable to this agreement, the agreement shall be interpreted to make the maximum disclaimer or limitation permitted by the applicable state law. The invalidity or unenforceability of any provision of this agreement shall not void the remaining provisions. 1.f.6. Indemnity. You agree to indemnify and hold the foundation, the trademark owner, any agent or employee of the foundation, anyone providing copies of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works in accordance with this agreement, and any volunteers associated with the production, promotion and distribution of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol electronic works, harmless from all liability, costs and expenses, including legal fees, that arise directly or indirectly from any of the following which you do or cause to occur. A. Distribution of this or any Project Gutenberg trademark symbol work. B. Alteration, modification, or additions or deletions to any Project Gutenberg trademark symbol work. And C. Any defect you cause. Section 2. Information about the mission of Project Gutenberg trademark symbol. Project Gutenberg trademark symbol is synonymous with the free distribution of electronic works in formats readable by the widest variety of computers, including obsolete, old, middle-aged and new computers. It exists because of the efforts of hundreds of volunteers and donations from people in all walks of life. Volunteers and financial support to provide volunteers with the assistance they need are critical to reaching Project Gutenberg trademark symbol's goals and ensuring that the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol collection will remain freely available for generations to come. In 2001, the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation was created to provide a secure and permanent future for Project Gutenberg trademark symbol and future generations. To learn more about the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation and how your efforts and donations can help, see sections 3 and 4 and the foundation information page at www.gutenberg.org. Section 3. Information about the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation. The Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation is a non-profit 501(c)(3). Educational corporation organized under the laws of the state of Mississippi and granted tax-exempt status by the Internal Revenue Service. The foundation's IN or federal tax identification number is 64-6221541. Contributions to the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation are tax deductible to the full extent permitted by U.S. federal laws and your state's laws. The foundation's business office is located at 809 North 1500 West, Salt Lake City, UT 84116. 801-596-1887. Email contact links and up-to-date contact information can be found at the Foundation's website and official page at www.gutenberg.org/contact-section-4. Information about donations to the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation. Project Gutenberg trademark symbol depends upon and cannot survive without widespread public support and donations to carry out its mission of increasing the number of public domain and licensed works that can be freely distributed in machine-readable form accessible by the widest array of equipment, including outdated equipment. Many small donations, $1 to $5,000, are particularly important to maintaining tax-exempt status with the IRS. The foundation is committed to complying with the laws regulating charities and charitable donations in all 50 states of the United States. Compliance requirements are not uniform and it takes a considerable effort, much paperwork and many fees to meet and keep up with these requirements. We do not solicit donations in locations where we have not received written confirmation of compliance. To send donations or determine the status of compliance for any particular state, visit www.gutenberg.org/donate. While we cannot and do not solicit contributions from states where we have not met the solicitation requirements, We know of no prohibition against accepting unsolicited donations from donors in such states who approach us with offers to donate. International donations are gratefully accepted, but we cannot make any statements concerning tax treatment of donations received from outside the United States. U.S. laws alone swamp our small staff. Please check the Project Gutenberg web pages for current donation methods and addresses. Donations are accepted in a number of other ways, including checks, online payments, and credit card donations. To donate, please visit www.gutenberg.org/donate. Section 5. General information about Project Gutenberg trademark symbol. Electronic Works. Professor Michael S. Hart was the originator of the Project Gutenberg trademark symbol concept of a library of electronic works that could be freely shared with anyone. For 40 years, he produced and distributed Project Gutenberg trademark symbol ebooks with only a loose network of volunteer support. Project Gutenberg trademark symbol ebooks are often created from several printed editions, all of which are confirmed as not protected by copyright in the US unless a copyright notice is included. Thus, we do not necessarily keep ebooks in compliance with any particular paper edition. Most people start at our website, which has the main PG search facility, www.gutenberg.org. This website includes information about Project Gutenberg trademark symbol, including how to make donations to the Project Gutenberg Literary Archive Foundation, how to help produce our new ebooks, and how to subscribe to our email newsletter to hear about new ebooks.